Sword Quest is an unfinished series of video games produced by Atari Incorporated in the 1980s as part of a contest consisting of three finished games and a planned but never released fourth game.
Mm-hmm.
Each of the games came with a comic book that explained the plot, as well as containing part of the solution to a major puzzle that had to be solved to win the contest, with a series of prizes on offer whose total value was $150,000.
Yep, and considering the inflation, that's a lot of fucking money. Like, god damn, Moneybags would be shitting his fucking pants if he heard that competition was a thing.
What competition?
Harry, do you remember Sword Quest from Atari?
I never had an Atari.
Oh, well, back in the days, in the 80s, there was a competition held by Atari to play Sword Quest games and find clues and
Wait, no, I know what you're talking about. It, then it was like that you could actually find a sword or like a gold ring and
yeah,
crazy
you,
shit like
yeah,
that, right?
Yeah, you could win that kind of stuff, and it was the expensive kind of stuff. $150,000.
Jesus.
And you know,
how could they have afforded to have done that?
I have no idea how they afforded it, but they did. The damn things actually exist.
Well, yeah, no, they didn't really afford it, considering that, according to this Wikipedia page, however, the series was unable to hold the last two contests along with the grand final contest, as well as release the final game in the series due to Atari's financial problems leading up to and being part of the video game crash of 1983.
Yeah, they weren't able to finish a competition, but the prizes were actually made, all of them. And they,
well, yeah,
they
okay,
do exist
but...
still. It's just a question of where the fuck did they end up in?
Well, what were the prizes?
One of them was a crown. Another one was a sword. Then there
let's
was
see,
a
there's...
Yeah, you have a I list. Just read
yeah,
it out.
Let's see. There was a talisman of penultimate truth. It was made of 18 karat solid gold with 12 diamonds and the birthstones of the 12 zodiac signs and in it, as well as a small sword made of white gold attached to the front. And the talisman was valued at that time $25,000. And
damn.
Yeah. Okay, then there was the fire world, which was the chalice of light. Was made out of gold and platinum and adorned by citrines, diamonds, green jade, pearls, rubies, and sapphires.
Ooh, that
it
does
had
sound
a value,
pretty.
It had a value of 25,000 too. And the guy that won it says he is still in the possession of the chalice. And the first guy with all the swords and what, he melted the talisman to pay the taxes.
What the fuck, man?
And he kept the bowls and the sword, but the sword apparently was stolen.
Well, I mean, truth be told, that does not surprise me in the slightest.
Yeah, then there is the water world. And, wait. Was supposed to receive the crown of life, which is made of gold, encrusted with aquamarines, diamonds, green tourmalines, rubies, and sapphires. It was valued at 25,000. But they cancelled at last minute because of the video game crash. The winners of the Earth World and Fire World competition received 15,000 because they couldn't get to the final ones, and then there was Air World, which never got released. But the winner of it was supposed to receive a Philosopher's Stone, which was a large piece of white jade encased in an 18 karat gold box encrusted with diamonds, emeralds, citrines, and rubies.
Hot
that was
damn,
also 25,000. And he was also scheduled to face off against the other four, the other three, for the grand prize, which was a sword with a gold handle encrusted with jewels and a blade made of pure silver. The sword, called the Sword of Ultimate Sorcery, was valued at 50 grand.
Hot damn, man. But seriously, what the fuck? Why did he melt the damn talisman? That's fucking stupid. He could have sold
it. Pay his taxes. I mean, look, if...
He could have sold it. It would have been worth a lot more then.
No, honestly, the thing is, if you have a second, the thing is, it's an art piece, but that means, again, it has to be, you know, something people want. What it seems like to me is that, basically, it was cheap, it was less than the sum of its parts. raw gemstones and whatnot that have already been cut are very valuable on their own.
I don't know. It just feels kind of shameful that he had to do it.
I mean, for all we know, he could have just sold it, and then it was then later melted down.
Maybe. If that's the case, well, whatever. But if he got it melted down first and then sold it, man.
Well, that would be a lot more profitable. That would be a lot more profitable back in the day.
Still, it is pretty cool that they managed to pull it off with a series of video games, despite the fact it didn't work out in the end.
Well, kind of, that made them bankrupt, so, you know.
Yeah, if they actually managed to avoid getting bankrupt, I'm pretty sure that would have been the coolest fucking thing ever.
Well, yeah, I mean, it worked for 3. So, you know.
It sounds maybe fucking awesome.
Maybe if I was born in, like, the 70s, I would have partaken, too.
Man. And what other competition similar to this do you know? I don't know a single one.
Let's see, maybe we can Google this.
I've never seen a single other competition on the scale as Sword Quest.
Well, you know, there's Dota 2, which goes for a lot of millions if you win it.
Oh, but,
I mean,
but
I would definitely say if you're gonna...
Well,
I think he means more like contests less than competitions.
Yeah, because Dota 2 is just, well, it's a strategy game more or less. It's,
well, still, you know,
it's not really on the same scale as Sword Quest, because
you know,
just about anyone could get into it.
Well, yeah, but still, you know, you have those hardcore people that played for 23 hours a day
and still have a huge losing fucking ratio. Just
yeah,
like Chiba,
again,
actually,
you know,
now that I think about it.
Then suddenly, you know, you're into that competition, you're the best of your country, you're in that competition. You win it, and then suddenly, here you go, you know, 20 million, or 200 million. Yeah, 200 million.
After taxes, have fun.
Well, that depends, because in Belgium, the taxes are calculated on, you know, your income, and not so much on your gross total.
Sounds pretty cool.
So, you know, you'd have to pay a lot of taxes because technically it's a source of income, but still, you know, if you play it smart, that's pretty much all the taxes that you have to pay. You just have to put it on a lot of different banks and invest it into a lot of different things.
I guess.
But yeah, still, you know, if okay, you're in a team of what, 4 or 5? But still, 200 million divided by 4 or 5, that still leaves, you know...
That's a shitload of cash.
That's still some nice pocket change.
Pocket change? Maybe for money bags. Oh yeah, by the way,
like...
we're doing a mini game where you have to catch these crystals when they shoot out of the geysers. Do it faster before Hunter. And in this second round, Hunter is not fucking around.
Hunter kind of looks a little,
He looks like an asshole right now.
No, his icon looks a little like a pig.
No, what he looks like to me is a fucking asshole who thinks he can win. He nearly did, actually. He's really good at the second round, so you gotta be careful with that shit.
Anyway, just imagine, you know, your parents, are along with friends, they're talking about their kids. Oh, what is your kid? Oh, mine's a lawyer. Yeah, mine's a doctor. What's your kid? Oh, he's a professional video game player. What? He won 200 million just yesterday.
Yeah, once you say that he won actual money, then they start taking him seriously. Up until that
point, that's the thing, it adds legitimacy to competitions and contests. I mean, the thing is that, while indeed it is kind of ugly to put money attached to most things, money is where legitimacy starts really coming into play.
Yeah.
Well, that depends, you know, you can sell a lot of drugs and get money. Shit.
You know what I mean.
Well, yeah, but yeah, I don't know, there's always a certain, I don't know, skeptical view about it.
Well,
like,
the thing is, most people who don't really get into video games for various reasons, we just think it's a thing for little kids. But really, it's for anyone who has the time and interest.
Still, you know, what the hell would you do with 200 million just by playing a bunch of games?
I'd pay my taxes.
I would say you then, yeah. I'd say then reinvest it into more skill.
Well, yeah, but you know,
if you
look at those kids, they're like, some of the kids are fucking younger than I am, and they win like millions, and it's like,
also,
what the fuck
are
you doing so much
they're
money?
They're always Korean.
Mostly Korean. It wasn't the winner of the last Korean StarCraft tournament not a Korean?
Oh yeah, no, I remember, actually, I recently
heard
about
that.
That
was actually pretty funny to see.
It was basically this American who had been training really long, really hard for this, and he just basically came in and slapped him around.
He came in and showed Koreans how to liberate.
Well, you know, it's not just in Korea, like, there is a Dota event in Germany, too. Like, there's a guy that I knew who actually went to Germany to watch it, and it's like, dude, what, why?
Yeah, and there's, that's all, that's only Dota, all things considered. There's also other games. Counter-Strike is probably the most popular of all the esports.
Well, yeah, but still, Dota 2 is by far the most, you know, you can make the most money with Dota 2, actually. In one go, that is.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know how, because, like, the game is fucking free!
Thanks to Valve fucking up. Alright, just... let's see. Ah, oh, here's this dickheaded level, which we will not be able to 100%, so I'll just run through it. Because the only other thing left besides this is the speedway. You know what? I think if they're going to get this, and if I remember correctly, the game will just throw me out to the boss. I think they'll just do that and do the speedway next time. Because I kind of want to end the session already.
Yeah.
Oh, here's some more dickheads. There seems to be a running gag in this fucking hub world. All the levels you go to are full of dicks. But here, apples seem to give superpowers to little hippo people. Unfortunately, they don't always help. In this guy's case, he got stuck. Fat bastard. So we are now in the shady oasis, where there are shady looking people and not so shady looking hippos with fez hats. And look at that, his name is Shorty. Nice fucking name, Shorty. Shoot the apple tree for him, which is apparently a berry tree or berry bush, I don't know. It doesn't look like a bush to me. And one of the apples drops down, and the hippo gets to eat it. He eats it, he powers up into a super hippo state for a few seconds, and he opens up the way for you. That's all you really need to know. Nothing really special about this level. Only one other thing to keep in mind, you will not be able to 100% this level yet.
Yet?
Still need that head stomp.
Jesus.
Not too fond of this kind of progression. I'd prefer if they didn't put levels with minigames that you can't complete right away. But at least it's not some ridiculous fucking number like 3 million fucking minigames or all minigames. At least here it only ever goes as bad as 2. So it's not that big of a deal. Still, I prefer none. But I can't complain, really. I mean, after all the shit that I've seen recently in other games, especially Dark Souls 3, I can't really complain about any problems in other games, because they seem so minuscule in comparison.
Yeah.
I mean, fuck. Lately, I've been getting so many bugs on Dark Souls 3 that I don't even know how to feel about it anymore. I'm feeling conflicted about whether or not I like it. Here's a fun one that happened yesterday, actually. Harry, do you know those fucking giant snake dudes in Archdragon's Peak?
Yes.
You know how some of them have axes on long chains, right?
Right.
Well, one of them threw an axe at me, but I skillfully dodged, because why the hell wouldn't you? It's not that hard. But then he drags the axe back, and somehow it hits me by being like a good, I don't know, half a meter away from my back. Just fucking clips me with the invisible hitbox. And I died because of that. I call fucking bullshit. It doesn't help that the camera often has a seizure by doing fucking nothing. It really pisses me off. Seriously, the entire Dark Souls series has a really aching problem with camera, and surprisingly enough, nobody complains about it. Here we go. That takes care of Shady Oasis. And what the surprise. The talisman is a genie lamp.
Of course it is.
Who ate all the apples?
You did.
I don't eat apples. This guy did.
Are you sure?
Absolutely. I mean, look at him. He looks very American. What happened to his hand? Oh wait, never mind. I thought his hand glitched out. Shit. I felt like the lower part of his arm just went missing. It kinda looked like it. Oh well. Will be the first time a PS1 game glitched out. Oh yeah, look at that. Now that you have all 14 talismans, your guidebook can break the lock on this door. Bring him on! But first I wanna heal. So yeah, there you go. Second hub world is complete. All things considered. All we need to do now is kill the boss, and we can go to the last hub world. And from there on, it's gonna be mostly cleanup. Because at that point, once you get to the third hub world, if you were playing as well as I did, you don't need to do anything. You can go straight for the boss. Which actually makes you win the game.
Wait, like, the whole game?
Yeah.
Don't you have to fight the third guy?
Yeah, that would be the third guy. In the third hub world, you fight Ripto.
Ah.
But the thing is, you don't need to beat any of the levels in the third hub world, because we don't give talismans. You already have all of them. There's only 14, apparently. Which is alright, I suppose. They don't really do anything anyway, so I'm fine with that. Alright, now we go into Gulp's Overhang, I believe it's called. And here's Gulp, the quadrupedal thingamajigger.
How was the first guy called again?
Crush. He died by getting crushed.
And this guy, Gulp, will probably die because you eat him?
Nah, I'm not big enough for that. As you can see, Ripto is being a rip-roaring dick, but he doesn't get away with feeding a fairy to Gulp. You singed my cape, you little shit! Don't you know I paid $500 for this?
You can jump pretty high though.
It's the same thing as with any villains. I mean, Robotnik can run away and outrun Sonic. I mean, how the fuck does that even make sense? Okay, so basically Ripto is gonna be the spectator in this whole thing, while Gulp will try to do his best to beat the shit out of you. Somehow, during the transition, however, he got himself a nice fucking turret on his back. How the fuck did he get that? I don't know. One thing I do have to say, though, is that you cannot hurt him with your normal attacks. You have to use things that are dropped to onto the arena by these helpful birds. Unfortunately for you, they're never the same thing. You're always gonna be alternating between items. It's always explosives. Like, before we had a battle, now we have some bombs. Bombs are the least useful because you actually have to spit them towards Gulp and make sure they hit them. It's a pretty cool boss fight, all things considered, but make sure that whatever the fuck you do, one, you do not get hit with explosives in your mouth, you will lose them, and two, you do not let him eat the explosives, he will use them.
How do all these birds get here?
It's an overhang, they can just fly in.
Yeah, but you know, it's very conspicuous that they suddenly decide to, hey, you know, instead of using the white sky, let's just fly into this tiny little room with these things on our legs and, you know, just drop them inside.
They're here to help us. They're our allies.
Oh, so it's like Gandalf when he wants to get the hell out of Saruman's tower.
Except they're not dealing with Saruman, they're dealing with a fucking giant dinosaur thing. Who knows how to use a turret, by the way. And every time you hurt him, he shoots more and shoots a little faster. Eventually, he'll get fucking pissed.
Same difference, though.
No. Ah, son of a bitch.
A little different.
Another problem is that you have to watch out not to get the turret shoot the explosives. It'll also detonate them. Anything detonates the bloody things. Luckily, I stopped Gulp from exploding in fiery diarrhea because he ate one of the exploding barrels. And you know what? He actually is the easier version of one of the Spyro 3 boss fights, which you'll be seeing much later. I don't remember what he's called, but that guy is much more difficult than this one.
Do you guys know that there'll be a supermoon today?
Oh, really?
I've heard of that.
Well, I guess I'll have to look out for it and see if it actually looks any super.
I think it was like at 2 a.m. or something that it was the best noticeable.
I hope it's noticeable at all. Last time they said there's gonna be a supermoon, and you know what? It was fucking cloudy. Thanks. Oh yeah, by the way, try not to get hurt, because you'll only get a chicken once you reach green health, which is low. And you'll only get one. So, you'll pretty much always be sitting on life support if you get hurt too much. This fucker is getting aggressive, but it makes sense. He's nearly dead. I don't think he's ever gonna get much faster than this. Or maybe he does. I know he likes to I wanna say either him or the boss equivalent in Spyro 3 that likes to spaz out and spam the living daylights out of their guns. But I don't remember which one does it. Probably not this one. I know he likes to shoot a lot. That's about it. But he's much easier. Especially when he gets rockets to shoot, because he can aim those. And there you go. He gets blown the fuck out.
I wonder though, why don't you have a health bar?
I do. My health bar is the dragonfly.
No, right. Maybe you should play Bully sometime.
I don't have a Bully.
You can always acquire it.
I don't really want to, actually.
It's a very fun game.
I know, but I don't want to play it. Alright, well, you can't hear it, Dog and Harry, but the lore here just explains that we apparently won the game. But
what? But
that's not true. It's the fake out.
So you didn't 100% everything?
No, this is the fake out ending, which is not an ending. She basically just says that there's no sign of Rekt, so there you go. Here's a makeshift vacation set. Go rest. Fucker.
Then before Rekt comes and blows up her cozy chair.
Nah, he definitely blows something up. Just not
this. Is Spyro sleeping?
Yeah. And here's the third hub world, Winter Tundra. But wait, it's a cutscene! Oh, look at that! It's that super portal thing. Seems like it has quite a few new orbs and this nice little ruby. Apparently it boosts the power of the super portal. Wow. Now what could they possibly want to do with this thing? Well, I don't know. Hey, wait a minute. That's not an orb. Fuck! Man, what the fuck? What kind of villain uses bombs of all things? I mean, he can use magic, but he uses a bomb?
An effective one, I guess? I mean, they're bombs. Quick, the power crystal. Don't
even try it, book boy, or you'll be a little smart. I guess, but I don't know. I mean, someone who can do magic, I don't really see them using bombs. And oh wow, look at that! He stole the ruby. Wow, what a shocker! And Hunter was just told to do something about it, like stop Rekt and whatnot. And he's like, "Hey, give that back!" by the time Ripto was up at the top of the stairs. And, well, he just said, well, I tried. And that, I think that was a funny scene. And, why aren't you fucking laughing?
Oh, God.
Oh, and I think Moneybags got booted the fuck out of the castle again. Did I miss that part? Did he actually get booted out? I think he did.
Maybe.
Maybe. You better fucking tell me. Spyro, Ripto's still alive! Oh no! No fucking shit. He did fall down a pit, but that doesn't mean he died. Oh yeah, look at this metal chest. You can only destroy it with a head stomp. Speaking of which, before we finish this session, let's get the head stomp. Wells. There's only one more thing you can do, and you gotta pay $1,000 to learn head stomp, which is actually called head bash, but whatever. Alright, so we paid a hefty sum for the head bash. How do we do the head bash? Simple. Find a target that can be head bashed, jump, and press triangle. And there you go.
Can't every enemy get head bashed?
I think they can, but why the hell would you want to do that?
I know. For fun.
It's too situational for its own good. But there you have it. We have completed the second hub world. Next session, we're going to clean up what we have left in the second hub world to make sure it's fully 100%. Then come back here and deal with whatever's left. So with that said, I'm Walder Richards from the Game Train, and
I'm Harry.
And that was Harry, yes.
And I'm no one.
And that was Dog, yes. And we'll be back after these messages, I guess.
After these commercials.
Fuck. I thought I disconnected. Oh well. See you soon. We'll be back. Eventually.